looplibrary.co.uk.
Copyright 2008 Sunum. All rights reserved. Explore, wonder, discover. http://worldwideweb.sunum.us. www.sunmun.us. Sunum. Sealed, except to the open mind. My Sunum Bonum Amen Ra. The Sunum philosophy is simply based on nature's own workings. It is nothing new and has been passed along throughout the ages. References to it may be found all around, in other religions and philosophies. Nature expresses it every day. While a full explanation is not given here, the philosophy is covered in depth through the book Sunum, Sealed, Except to the Open Mind, which is freely available from our website. Topics of even greater depth are examined inside the Pyramid, which is a collection of discourses given by Corky Ra. Introduction. When the student's mind is open, then comes the voice to fill it with wisdom. Sunum. This book is dedicated with gratitude to the Sunum individuals who untiringly work the pathways of spiritual evolution, and who with great concern have presented to me these principles. These teachings cannot be accredited to any one person or human source, for these teachings represent the workings of creation itself. These principles have been presented previously to those souls evolved enough to understand them, and again the nature of creation is presented to those now ready. 1. The Sunum Philosophy. The voice of wisdom is silent, except to the open mind. Sunum. The Sunum philosophy embodies the principles of creation itself. From grand cycle to grand cycle, the fundamental esoteric teachings of the Sunum Bonum are taught to select advanced souls who then progress to new spiritual levels. The last recorded reservoir of these teachings on planet Earth has been found in Egypt, a home of the pyramids. All nations have borrowed from the ancient inheritance of Egypt. India, Persia, China, Japan, ancient Greece, Rome, and other countries partook liberally at the feast of knowledge which the masters of the land of Ra and Isis so freely provided for them. The grand principle of creation is presented here for your examination. It is the answer to the greatest mysteries which dwell within the thinking human mind. No record of this principle may be found anywhere except within this book. With diligence and openness, study, learn, and apply the principles and techniques presented in this work. As you progress, you will gain an understanding and come to know the grand principle of creation. Before the material universe manifested, there was no thing. If there was no thing, nothing, then it must have been possible for nothing to be. If it is possible for no thing to be, then it must be possible for everything to be. All matter, space-time, all relativity, all this must be possible. If there is all possibility, then there must be the possibility of the no-thing, nothing. In the same fashion, it must be possible for all things to be, summum. Automatically, with no beginning and no end, do these grand opposites come in and out of bond infinite times in a finite moment, therefore creating a series of infinite events. These infinite events, held within the finite moment of singularity, manifest as infinite conceptualized energy that is then externalized through phenomenal, inconceivable projections, limitless in number. Among these countless projections, one produced your universe through an extreme rapid expansion, what has been called the Big Bang, an event. In essence, there are infinite Big Bangs creating infinite universes whose origin is an eternal, finite moment of infinite events, all produced by nothing and possibility. A corollary to this grand principle is, it is impossible for two things to join in harmony or discord without the presence of a third, for a bond must exist to unite them. The copulation generates summum. It is the bonding of nothing and possibility infinite times within this finite moment which is the birth of the cosmos and all subsequent events. It takes the joining of two to make one, summum. Although your physicists and astronomers have determined the origin of the material universe, they are incapable of determining the moment just prior to the Big Bang. This cannot be examined by formulas, because formulas use the methodology of the material universe. just prior to the event, singularity, space-time and therefore matter did not exist, so it is impossible to make formulations based upon the non-reality of these systems. To be totally correct, one would have to say there was no moment just prior to the Big Bang, for time did not exist. So when physicists try to examine the origin of the creation, they must be confined to studying philosophical states, and they are not comfortable doing this at this time. Physicists who deal in quantum mechanics state, you cannot, objectively, observe something without changing it in the process. This statement is based upon what is termed the uncertainty principle, which means that, when you observe one aspect of a thing, such as an electron, you are forever uncertain of any other aspects of that same thing when consequently, they are restricted to using collections of probabilities in describing the motion of things. Further, they state that the existence of the collection of probabilities establishes what would happen if an observation occurred. Note that the term probabilities is closely related to the term possibilities. To the extent that the uncertainty principle is applied to the origin of the universe, you can readily understand the problem with the physicist's objective measurements, observations. No objective measurements are possible in solving this problem. The grand principle of creation embodies your subjective observation of creation itself, in which the process of observation between nothing and possibility produces the event of creation. This condition, in which the two grand opposites are poised in opposition to one another, results in summum, the sum total of everything. When one state of being observes another, there is created an automatic connection between the two. It is this relationship between possibility and nothing which generates this incredible event. The event includes all outward manifestations and appearances which you know under the terms of the material universe, the phenomena of life, matter, energy, space-time, distance, speed, relativity, and, in short, all that is apparent to your material senses. Summum, created by the copulation of nothing and possibility, is spirit, and may be considered and thought of as a universal, infinite, living mind. This mind is the effect of creation's copulation, manifesting the qualities of nothingness and, summum, possibility. From the copulation of creation emanates the seven great principles of summum, psychokinesis, correspondence, vibration, opposition, rhythm, cause and effect, and gender. These principles are the nature of the grand copulation of creation. 1. Despite the uncertainty principle's significant role in quantum mechanics, it can only be considered partially true due to the effect of paradox. The divine paradox, which is discussed later in this work, reveals that all truths are only partially true and must be applied in the examination of anything. The Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen thought experiment demonstrates the ability to know more information about a system than the uncertainty principle would allow, hence the infamous Eppler paradox. The recent demonstration of teleportation through entanglement, which utilizes Eppler beams to transport quantum states from one point to another, exploits the restrictions of uncertainty. Yet regardless of the methods scientists use to examine the universe, as long as they confine themselves to objective measurements, observation, the mystery of creation will always remain elusive. 3. 7 Summum Principles. The principles of knowing creation are seven. Those who know these possess the magic key to whose touch all locked doors open to creation. Summum. The seven great summum principles upon which the summum philosophy is based are, as follows, I. Second. Third. Fourth. V. Sixth. Seventh. The principle of psychokinesis. The principle of correspondence. The principle of vibration. The principle of opposition. The principle of rhythm. The principle of cause and effect. The principle of gender. These seven great principles will be discussed and explained at length in this work. A short explanation of each, however, will be given at this point, for all the principles of summum have an interrelationship with each other. the objective observation of creation, including the principles of psychokinesis, correspondence, vibration, opposition, rhythm, cause and effect, and gender, requires a discussion of proportion, for all seven principles of summum can be objectively discussed in their relation to proportion. It is the influence of the rule of proportion on the objective observer which causes humankind to ascribe to creation human emotions, feelings, and characteristics. Through genetics, all these descriptions survive from the days of the childhood of the race. This depiction of creation is the natural memory held within every cell of your body inherited from the evolution of the race. You are genetically bound and bound within your essence, for it is your inheritance. The objective observer, bound by the rule of proportion in the examination of the existent universe, discovers both an organized universe and a universe in chaos, rational and irrational numbers, beauty and ugliness, love and hate, pleasure and pain, harmony and discord, sanity and insanity, truth and falsity. These descriptions are merely proportional effects of opposition and the other principles of summum. The objective observers within this universe see harmony expressed by those emotions, feelings, and characteristics present within themselves. This harmony is viewed within nature and the universe as the divine proportion. Although the proportions seem to be fixed in nature, they are not. The only reason they seem fixed is because they are fixed within the observer's mind. These fixed mental vibrations dictate the observer's likes and dislikes, happiness and sadness. They also dictate one's sense of pleasure and pain, beauty and ugliness, love and hate, truth and falsity, resulting in one being captive of these memories fixed by both body and mind. For, if the observer were to view nature from an altered state of consciousness, the proportion would also be altered. From a quantum viewpoint, multiple fields of consciousness are viewed simultaneously. If you could behold the consciousness of both a snail and a human simultaneously, you would realize that pieces of gravel are as boulders to snails but pebbles to humans. Times and lengths, space-time, and mass are all altered in proportion when the body concerned is in motion relative to the observer. In other words, moving bodies appear to be altered in terms of their shape, size, and speed, depending on your viewpoint. Apparent increase of mass in swiftly moving particles has been observed. For example, when an electron is accelerated, it appears to gain Massachusetts. Einstein's special theory of relativity embodies the mathematical essence of proportion and the interrelationship of the principles of summum. An altered state of consciousness makes a quantum leap beyond any fixed state of observation, demonstrating that the divine proportion is also subject to the law of paradox and only partial truth. The divine proportion ascribed to the collective consciousness of your state of evolution has been expressed, for of three magnitudes, if the greatest, ob is to the mean, cb as the mean, cb is to the least, ac, they therefore all shall be one. The principle of cause and effect underlies all scientific thought, ancient and modern. While many and varied disputes between the many disciplines have since arisen, they have been principally about the details of the operations of the principle and sometimes about the meaning of certain words. The underlying principle of cause and effect has been accepted as correct by all scientists and metaphysicians. To believe otherwise would be to take the phenomena of the universe from the domain of law and order and relegate it to the control of the imaginary, a circumstance which humans call chance. A little consideration will prove that there can be no such agent as pure chance. Webster defines the word chance as the happening of events without apparent cause. In a sense, one would be saying that an event is outside of law, beyond the laws of cause and effect. How can something act in the phenomenal universe independent of the laws, order, and continuity of the universe? Such a thing would be entirely independent of the universe and therefore superior to it. Yet there is nothing outside of summum belonging to such a law, because summum is the law in itself. There is no room for something outside of and independent of law. The existence of such a thing would render all natural laws ineffective and would plunge the universe into chaotic disorder and lawlessness. Careful examination will show that what you call chance is merely an expression relating to obscure causes, causes that you cannot perceive, causes that you cannot understand. The word chance is derived from the word meaning to fall, as the falling of dice, which approximates the idea that the fall of the dice is merely a happening and related to any cause. This is the sense in which the term is generally used. But upon closer examination, it can be determined that there is no chance whatsoever concerned with the fall of the dice. Each time a die falls and displays a certain number, it obeys a law as infallible as that which governs the revolution of the planets around the sun. Behind the fall of the die are causes or chains of causes extending further than the mind could trace. They may include the position of the die in the hand, the amount of muscular energy exerted in the throw, the condition of the table, etc. All are causes, the effect of which may be perceived. Yet beyond these seen causes are chains of unseen preceding causes, all having a bearing upon the number on the die which comes up. If a die is tossed a great number of times, the count of each number that comes up will turn out to be nearly equal, that is, an equal number of 1 spots, 2 spots, 3 spots, etc. Toss a coin in the air and it may come down either heads or tails. But make a sufficient number of tosses, and the heads and tails will about even up. This is the operation of the law of averages. Both the averages and the single toss come under the law of cause and effect. If you were able to examine the preceding causes, it would be clear that it was simply impossible for the die to fall other than it did under the circumstances and at that time. Given the same causes, the same results will follow. There is always a cause and a because to every event. Nothing ever happens without a cause or, rather, a chain of causes. Some confusion exists by those considering this principle due to the fact that they are unable to explain how one thing could cause another, that is, how one thing is the creator of a second thing. As a matter of fact, no thing ever causes or creates another thing. Cause and effect deals only with events. An event is that which comes, arrives, or happens as a result or consequent of some preceding event. No event creates another event, but is merely a preceding link in the great orderly chain of summum. The events are the bonds between cause and effect, the force and energy of creation. There is continuity between all events precedent, consequent, and subsequent. There is relation existing between everything that has gone before and everything that follows. A stone is dislodged from a mountainside and crashes through a roof of a cabin in the valley below. At first, you may regard this as a chance effect or act of God. But when you examine the matter, you find a great chain of causes behind it. In the first place, there was the rain which softened the earth, supporting the stone and allowing it to fall. Besides the rain was the influence of sun and wine which gradually chiseled the piece of rock from a larger piece. Then there were the causes which led to the formation of the mountain, its upheaval by convulsions of nature, and so on ad infinitum. Then you might follow the weather patterns which produced the rain, and the materials that the roof was composed of. In short, you would find yourself involved in a mesh of cause and effect from which you would soon strive to disentangle yourself. Just as a human has 2 parents, and 4 grandparents, and 8 great-grandparents, and 16 great-great-grandparents, and so on, until the number of ancestors run into many millions, so is it with the number of causes behind even the most trifling event or phenomenon. Consider the passage of a tiny speck of soot before your eye. It is not an easy matter to trace the bit of soot back to the early period of the planet's history, when it formed a part of a large tree. Follow it from the tree which was converted into coal, to the coal which fueled a fire, to the speck of soot now passing before your eyes on its way to other adventures. A mighty chain of events, causes and effects brought the speck of soot to its present condition. It is but one of a chain of events which will produce other events continuing on hundreds of years from now, and including the inspiration for this next description. Let us examine the task of rewriting these lines for this day and age. Utilizing a computer and word processing program, we input, convert, and store data on a floppy disk. The floppy disk is inserted into a typesetting computer. The typesetting computer produces and prints out the set type. Proofreaders then perform their job. The edited copy is sent to the printer. The printer prints the book. The book is distributed to bookstores. You see this book in a bookstore and buy it. You read it, and it arouses certain thoughts in your mind and that of others reading it, which in turn affects others, and so on, and on, and on. The events continue beyond the ability of humans to calculate further. Just ponder a moment. If a certain man had not met a certain woman in the dim period of the Stone Age, you who are now reading these lines would not be here in the form that you now inhabit. Every thought you think, every act you perform, has its direct and indirect results which fit into the great chain of cause and effect. In consideration of free will, remember the law of paradox. On one hand, you do make choices and direct your lives on a conscious level. But the direction of those choices are a result of cause and effect, and the partially wise become disillusioned by their refusal of the acceptance of destiny. The summum teachings are that humankind is both free and yet bound by necessity, depending upon the meaning of the terms and the level at which the matter is examined. That is, because the further the creation is from the center, the more bound it is. As it comes closer to the center, the more free it becomes. The majority of humans are more or less slaves of heredity and environment and exhibit very little freedom. They are swayed by the opinions and customs of the exterior world, and also by their own emotions, feelings, moods, etc. They show very little mastery of self. They indignantly protest this assertion, saying, "Why, I certainly am free to act and do as I please. I do just what I want to do." They fail to explain where the want to, and as I please come from. What makes them want to do this, that, or anything? The Summa Master can change these pleases and wants into the will to will, instead of being moved, because some feeling, mood, emotion, or environmental suggestion arouses a tendency or desire within them to do so. They are the masters of their desire, not a slave to their passion. The majority of humans are manipulated by heredity and internal moods, desires, etc. Not to mention outside influences such as the suggestions and will of others stronger than themselves. They are carried along without resistance on their part or the exercise of their will. Moved like pawns on the chessboard of life, they play their parts and are laid aside after the game is over. But the masters, knowing the rules of the game, rise above the level of material life. By placing themselves in touch with the higher powers of their nature, they dominate their own moods, characters, qualities, and vibration as well as the environment surrounding them. Thus they become movers in the game, instead of pawns, causes instead of effects. The Summa Masters do not escape the causation of the higher levels, but become one with the higher laws. They form a conscious part of the law, rather than being its blind instrument. While they serve on the higher levels, they rule on the material level. On all levels of existence, the law is always in operation and ever in evidence. Look at the phenomenon of the deep trance medium who gives guidance by allowing its body to be used by a disembodied, earthbound spirit. This is due to the cycle of the law of cause and effect. There is the want and desire of the disembodied, earthbound spirit to participate in the embodied game of the material level. There is the want and desire of the medium who is being used to channel other entities to participate in the game of the spiritual ego. Throughout the ages, the word spirits referred to liquids containing ethanol. Since ancient times, only the highest masters were capable of altering these liquids into storage vessels of living knowledge. These masters operate in harmony with higher laws of nature, so that they may rule on the lower levels of manifestation. The minds of those who consume the nectar publications are immersed in the living knowledge. Masculine vibrations are released within the minds of those fortunate students who use the liquids, and they plant the seeds of understanding creation. No suggestion is required for the vibrations to attune the mind, for they are literally baptized with the knowledge. The application of mental gender through the practice of meditation using these sacred publications of creation constitutes one of the earliest forms of religious worship, a form that scattered itself throughout history and extends itself into our modern times. The spirit of your ancestors resides within the sacred soma. It carries the knowledge of creation and awaits to enter you. These vessels of sacred religious worship will open your consciousness to mysteries you will never understand until you allow them to abide within your spirit, mind, and body. Many books, many of them quite good, have been written on the subject of mental gender. The main facts stated in these various books are correct, although the several writers have attempted to explain the phenomenon by various pet theories of their own. By using the theory of mental gender, the student will be able to bring order to the chaos of conflicting theory and teachings and readily make oneself the master of the subject, if so inclined. The consideration of the teachings of Summum may clear away many perplexing difficulties, a key that will unlock many doors. It is not necessary to go into detail regarding all of the many features of psychic phenomena and mental science. This material can be easily obtained by the student. With the aid of the Summum teachings, one may go through any library anew. This is not a new philosophy, but rather the outlines of a great world teaching which will make clear the teachings of others, serving as a great reconciler of differing theories and opposing doctrines. 17. Meditation. Where your attention is where you are. Summum. This great Summum axiom embodies the idea that all things are subject to the principles of Summum, including your attention and your spirit. Balance, bringing yourself to the point of equilibrium through balance between mind, body, and spirit produces the complete person. By neutralizing the swing of the pendulum, concentration is focused towards the center, between the opposing points of extremes. The mind surrenders through meditation, rhythmically dancing into the music of pure, alert, clear, total, undisturbed, and open consciousness in the presence of Summum, and the body is brought to sensitivity through dynamic, rhythmic dance, physical, exhaustive exercise. This ideal meditation is the grand master key to reconciliation and the powers of spiritual psychokinesis. With the reconciliation of the two extremes neutralized and brought into balance, the disciple allows for a smooth, continuous evolution. When the disciple develops the powers of spiritual psychokinesis, he or she becomes a master of the universes. Truly, it is magical. 18. Summum Axioms. The possession of knowledge, unless accompanied by an expression of action, is like the hoarding of precious metals, a vain and foolish thing. Knowledge, like wealth, is intended for use. The law of use is universal, and those who violate it suffer by reason of their conflict with natural forces. Summum. The Summum teachings are not intended to be merely stored away and secreted. If you don't use it, you'll lose it. Beware of mental miserliness and express into action that which you have learned. Study the axioms, but practice and teach them also. Given below are some of the more important Summum axioms with a few comments added to each. Make these your own and practice and use them, for they are not really yours until you have used and taught them. Experience is the best teacher. Summum. The systematic law of learning must be applied to all principles in order for one to have real knowledge rather than just belief. This learning requires you to first question the principle. Secondly, you must take activity in the principle and experience the action or the cause and effect of the principle. Thirdly, you move to a knowledge about, rather than a belief in the principle, for the principle and its workings become yours through experience. To change your mood or mental state, change your vibration. Summum. You may change your mental vibrations by an effort of will, by deliberately fixing the attention upon a more desirable state. Will directs the attention and attention changes your vibration. Cultivate the art of attention by means of the will, through meditation, and you have solved the secret of the mastery of moods and mental states. Strengthen and enlarge the will by accumulating kinetic energy from the field of that quote all action and manifested creation. convert the kinetic energy into potential energy and store it in the will through meditation. Summum. By accumulating kinetic energy and altering it to potential energy for use by the will, your will may be strengthened and enlarged. Energize the attention with potential energy from the will, then immerse the attention and the will within summum. While immersed in summum, your will and attention are energized with the very essences of creation. During this immersion, kinetic energy from the field of all action and manifested creation is altered into potential energy for storage in your will. To alter an undesirable rate of mental vibration, put into operation the principle of opposition and concentrate upon the opposite point of that which you desire to suppress. Dissolve the undesirable by withdrawing your attention from it. Summum. This is one of the most important of the summum formulas. It is based on true scientific principles. The mental state and its opposite are merely the two contrasting points on the same scale. By mental immersion, the vibration can be altered. This principle is known to modern psychologists, who apply it to the breaking up of undesirable habits by instructing their students to concentrate upon the opposing quality. If you are possessed of fear, do not waste time trying to kill it. Instead, cultivate the quality of courage and the fear will disappear. Some writers have expressed this idea most forcibly by using the illustration of the dark room. You do not clear out darkness. Just open the curtains, let in the light, and the darkness disappears. To dissolve a negative quality, concentrate the attention on the positive point of that same quality. The vibrations will gradually change from negative to positive, until finally you become fixed on the positive point. The reverse is also true, as many have found to their sorrow, when they allowed themselves to vibrate too constantly on the negative point. By changing your vibration, you may master your moods, change your mental states, remake your disposition, and build up character. Much of the mental mastery of the advanced masters is due to this application of immersion, which is one of the more important aspects of mental psychokinesis. Remember the summum axiom, which says mind, as well as metal and elements, may be altered psychokinetically, from state to state, degree to degree, proportion to proportion, condition to condition, point to point, vibration to vibration. Psychokinesis is mental mastery. The mastery of immersion is the mastery of the fundamental principle of psychokinesis or mental alteration. For, unless one acquires the art of altering their own vibration, they will be unable to affect their environment. An understanding of this principle will empower one to change their own vibration as well as that of others, if you will but devote the time, care, study, and meditative techniques necessary to master the art. The principle is true, but the results obtained depend upon the persistent patience and practice of the student. Rhythm may be neutralized by an application of the art of immersion. Summum. As explained in a previous chapter, summum holds that the principle of rhythm manifests on the mental levels as well as the physical. Further, the bewildering succession of moods, feelings, emotions, and other mental states are due to the backward and forward swing of the mental pendulum that carries you from one extreme of feeling to another. Summum also teaches that the law of neutralization enables one, to a great extent, to overcome the operation of rhythm. There are both higher and lower levels of consciousness. By rising mentally to the higher level, the master causes the swing of the mental pendulum to manifest on the lower level, and by dwelling on the higher level, escapes the consciousness of the swing backward. This is effected by immersing in the higher self, and thus raising the mental vibrations of the ego above those of the ordinary levels of consciousness. It is similar to the process of rising above a force and allowing it to pass beneath you. The advanced students immerse themselves at the positive point of their being, the point of spirit, rather than the point of personality. By refusing to participate in the operation of rhythm, they raise themselves above its level of function. Standing firm in their statement of being, they allow the pendulum to swing back upon the lower levels without changing their fixed position of immersion. This is accomplished by all individuals who have attained any degree of self-mastery, whether they understand the law or not. such persons simply refuse to allow themselves to be swung back by the pendulum of mood and emotion, and by steadfastly affirming the superiority of spirit, they remain fixed on the positive point. The masters, of course, attain a far greater degree of proficiency, because they understand the law which they are overcoming through the use of a higher law. By use of their will, they attain a degree of poise and mental steadfastness almost impossible to believe by those who allow themselves to be swung backward and forward by the mental pendulum of moods and feelings. Remember always, however, that you do not really destroy the principle of rhythm, for that is indestructible. You simply overcome one law by counterbalancing it with another, thus maintaining an equilibrium. The laws of balance and counterbalance are in operation on the mental as well as on the physical levels. An understanding of these laws seemingly enables one to overthrow laws, while in fact they are merely exerting a counterbalance. Nothing escapes the principle of cause and effect, destiny, but there are many levels of the law, and one may use laws of the higher to overcome the laws of the lower. Summum. An understanding of the practice of immersion allows you to rise to a higher level of cause and effect and thus counterbalance the laws of the lower levels. By rising above the level of ordinary causes you become, to a degree, a cause instead of an effect. Able to master your own moods and feelings and to neutralize rhythm, you are able to escape a great part of the operation of cause and effect on the ordinary level. The masses are carried along, obedient to their environment. The wills and desires of others overpower them, and the effects of memory and inherited tendencies rule them, so that they tend to move about on the chessboard of life like mere pawns. By rising above these influencing causes, the advanced student seeks a higher level of mental action and direction. Dominating their moods, emotions, impulses, and feelings, they create for themselves new characters, qualities, and powers through which they overcome their environment. They now become the players instead of mere pawns. Such people assist in the game of life, instead of being moved about this way and that by stronger influences, powers, and wills. They use the principle of cause and effect instead of being used by it. Of course, even the highest are subject to the principle as it manifests on the higher levels. But on the lower levels of activity they are masters instead of slaves. As Summum says, the wise serve on the higher, but rule on the lower. They obey the laws coming from above them, but on their own level and those below them they rule and give orders. Yet in so doing, they form a part of the principle instead of opposing it. The wise fall in with the law, and by understanding its movements operate it instead of being its blind slave. Just as the skilled swimmer turns this way and that way, goes and comes at will rather than being carried like a floating log, so are the wise, as compared to the novice. Yet both swimmer and log, wise and fool, are subject to law. Those who understand this are well on the road to mastery. True psychokinesis is a mental art. Summum. In the above axiom, Summum teaches that the great work of influencing one's environment is accomplished by mental power. The universe being wholly mental, it follows that it may be ruled only by mentality. In this fact is to be found an explanation of all the phenomena and manifestations of the various mental powers. In back of and underneath the teachings of the various disciplines remains ever constant the principle of the mental substance of the universe. If the universe be mental in its essence, then it follows that mental alteration must change the condition and phenomena of the universe. If the universe is mental, then mind must be the highest power affecting its events. If this be understood, then all the so-called miracles and wonder workings are seen plainly for what they are. There is no why. It merely is and is not. Summum. Why does Summum do what it does? Why is there life? Why is there being? These can be difficult questions to answer, and can be dealt with by saying that the questions are their own answers. Summum does for the cause of doing. Life is the reason for life. Being is for the cause of being. These can be difficult and perplexing considerations. Just know that you can be with these concepts, and through practicing the ideal meditation attain the realization that everything is and is not, simply because it is and is not, it is the result of creation's copulation. Summum is infinite, living mind. The universe is mental. The some individuals call it spirit. Summum. Your new physics, that of quantum mechanics, has proposed startling new theories, so far, as the scientific world is concerned, dealing with the behavior of the universe and the nature of reality. Quantum physicists are now faced with the conclusion that reality is a product of consciousness. Their study of subatomic particles, or more recently, quanta particles, suggests to them that these particles, as small as they appear, have a consciousness entirely their own. Such being the case at the quantum particle level, it must follow that all matter and energy in the physical universe has its own collective consciousness, since matter and energy are but groupings of these quanta particles. Therefore, the material universe itself has a consciousness all its own. Quantum physicists are faced with the question of the source of the consciousness of matter. As your physicists continue in their search for the source of the consciousness of matter, they will discover that all matter has spirit. This spirit they try to understand as a form of consciousness. The collective spirit of all the units and groupings of units is summum. It is this collective consciousness which makes up the infinite, living mind which is summum. Summum is not some sort of giant brain in the sky, but rather the life force energy produced by the event of the bonding between nothing and possibility. Just as your consciousness is much more encompassing than the organ that is called your brain, so is the infinite, living mind of summum that much greater than all the collective raw particles of the universe. Summum is infinite consciousness in all its varied aspects. The some individuals call it spirit. Creation manifests when balance is perfected between the opposites. By applying higher law against lower laws, the creation becomes divine. Summum. Under and behind all outward appearances or expressions of existence, behind all events, behind all circumstances, is the substantial essence, the bonding between nothing and possibility. It is for this reason that the universe is dual in its nature, and it is for this reason that spiritual development requires you to become conscious of that duality. Whenever you examine anything, be aware of the duality of that which you observe. Be aware of the two opposites which make it up to be what it is. Remember, where you find one thing, you will always find its opposite. By recognizing the duality of the universe, you can begin to look for the opposites in all events or circumstances, remembering always that the opposites are merely differing aspects of the same thing or event. In identifying the opposites, you can strive for balance between the two. Your perfection of balance between the opposites is achieved by the practice of the ideal meditation, for this practice will bring you to the point of equilibrium between body, mind, and spirit. This practice will move you to a perspective that is unencumbered by judgments and the constraints of a fixed mind. As you perfect your balance between the opposites, be ever aware of the correspondence between the levels of life and being. Keep in mind that the same principles are in effect at all the various fields and levels. Utilize the principle of correspondence to reason from the known to the unknown and observe the laws, as they operate on each level. Apply the law of a higher level against that of a lower level, for the law of a higher level dominates the lower. In perfecting your practice of the ideal meditation and becoming intimate with the summum principles, you will develop the powers of spiritual psychokinesis. Thus, you are able to easily and more readily use law against laws, the higher against the lower, and create a life and direction of your choosing. In such a position, you are most certainly in harmony with nature and truly your creations become divine. Amen. Epilogue. Energy can neither be created nor destroyed. It can only change from one form to another. While the principles cannot truly be lost, since they make up the fabric of existence, writings about them can be. Over time, many books have indirectly referred to them, but as a whole, the principles became diluted and distorted. Three individuals reintroduced the principles in an unadulterated form following an initiation back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. They wrote things down, progression continued, and today, there are people who meet in a pyramid for in-depth discussion about these concepts. Still, many people read about the principles, but don't do anything about it. They read and discuss and talk and read, but nothing happens with them. As the three initiates stated, you need to apply the principles in your life, use them, experience them, become part of them in order to make them real and truly understand them. So Corky started teaching about the principles at Summum, after he was initiated into them by the advanced beings, the Summum individuals, beings who are complete and whole. This is how Corky first found out about the principles. Then Ron introduced the Kybalion. Now when Corky looks back in life, he says there is a familiarity with things about the Kybalion that he did not realize until a certain point in his life. Ron had a familiarity possibly with people who had brought about the original publication of the Kybalion. At this point I should state the Kybalion makes a very significant omission. It does not contain the one grand principle from which all the other principles come. Perhaps this was on purpose. Perhaps it was too much for the people of the time to understand and the three initiates elected not to divulge it. But today there are a few people who can grasp it, for it was introduced to Corky during his initiation, and Corky introduced it to me and others who have been through initiations given at Summum. Today, there are some individuals who are attracted to this principle. There are people who have considered the idea in some fashion, even though it was never formally introduced to them. The principle of creation is the binding or birthing principle for the other principles of the Kybalion and Summum. They would not be without the principle of creation. While the principle may appear very abstract at first, when one becomes involved in serious study about it, the principle begins to reveal itself. And so, when Corky was preparing to write a book about the Summum philosophy, he decided to use the Kybalion as an outline, since this is essentially what the Kybalion discussed. The Kybalion had fallen into the public domain and under laws of the land Corky could create a derivative work from it. By adding the grand principle of creation to it, by discussing additional details about the principles along with further concepts, and by rewriting content in a style and language more appropriate for today's modern era, the Kybalion has evolved into Summum, sealed, except to the open mind. As the Kybalion states, all things change. The principles of creation are once again presented in a pure, complete, and contemporary manner. To truly understand these principles, you need to use them in your life. You will be attracted to these principles, as your essence becomes more and more familiar with their workings. Some people are already attracted to them because of work they have done in this or previous lifetimes. Others are not, for their work has yet to begin. Those of you who feel no affinity to these principles may first need to search and develop yourselves in other ways. But in the end, you will reach a point where you begin to study them and become initiated into them. There are people who, after discovering Summum, traveled hundreds, even thousands of miles to visit in Salt Lake. Something touched them and they felt compelled to come. For some, it signaled the start of something new. For others, it was picking up where they last left off. Either way, it becomes a time when the mysteries and wonder of the universe beckon, and nature invites you to dance with creation. Summum Bonum and Wa. Copyright 2008 Summum. All rights reserved. Explore, wonder, discover. http://worldwideweb.summum.us www.summum.us
LoopLibrary.co.uk